I think we should get started with the thing. Okay, first of all, welcome to DrupalCon and welcome to my session. Today, we're going to talk about automated mobile testing using APM. So first of all, I would like to introduce myself. Myself, Lokesh Soni. I am a software test engineer at Blistering Solutions, working with the automation of web as well as mobile applications. Also a manual test engineer. So the first thing which we are going to talk about is the need of mobile application automation testing. So what is the need of mobile automation testing? As we all are familiar about the desktop application testings, right? We do it manually, we do it by automation as well. So the web application for the desktop one are automated 90 to 100% most of the things. But we have most of the organizations have not started yet with the mobile application automation testing. So the first thing, as we have seen an explosive growth of smartphone apps since 2007, okay, so there's a huge market of mobile applications, as mobile applications are more reliable for most of the organizations. So in some cases, mobile apps bring half of their web traffic from the mobile. So instead of using a desktop application, people are more and more reliable on the mobile applications. Whereas in some cases, mobile applications are the only way where customers interact with their product. Okay, in this case, we can just take out some of the examples in the sense we can take Flipkart, Amazon. These have more reliability and these are more concerned about the mobile applications right now. There is no concern that they are not taking care about the web, but they are having more dependent on the mobile application now. No wonder that mobile application development process has become quick and efficient, which also gives high priority for the organizations. As the best is the mobile application, the more user friendly it is, the more interaction it gives to the customers. So fortunately, mobile development process tool has evolving meet needs this needs with modern dev teams, as mobile application development is move faster as compared to the previous time. We have different tools, we have well developed teams for the development of the applications. Development of the mobile applications have become more faster than the previous time. But what about the testing approaches? We are simply doing the manual testing still now for the mobile application, as the testing a mobile application is I can say more complex, it's time consuming, it's platform variations, there are the quality concerns. So I would like to talk about over here the difficulties coming in the testing of the mobile applications. As we see, more complex in the sense we just have to test if we are building for one particular Android device, one particular app. So we just have to test it out on different devices, such as the mobile versions and different things. Also, it is time consuming, as the manual work will be done. So for to check out each and everything, we just have to do all the things manually. Then comes is the platform variation. Sometimes we build only for the Android applications and sometimes we build only for the iOS applications. So we just have to test out both the different things, that is time consuming. And the more concerned thing is the quality. So if there is any lack in the quality, then the organization just cannot afford the loss of the customers. So so these are all the things which are the difficulties. So like manual mobile testing process, we should also adopt mobile automation testing. So there comes in question that why mobile automation testing? So this is various factors to adopt mobile automations are it is efficient, it is faster, it is reusability, then it is reliable, and it's cost reduction. Now let me explain you this particular thing as how it will be easier for us to adopt mobile automation testing. Efficient, faster reusability. So let's take an example over here. As most of the SDLC processes, the methodologies which companies use nowadays is the agile process, where they divide the requirements into sprint basis, and those sprints are divided, one particular development process is divided into different sprints. So whatever we develop in the sprint one, that is to be tested. After that we go to the sprint two. Sprint two, the same things which we developed in the sprint one is to be tested in sprint two as well. So to overlap this particular time of spending testing the things which were developed in the sprint one, that is that can be occupied by using the mobile automation. So whatever we automate, whatever the things which were built and tested in sprint one can be automated, and that can be used in the sprint two. Similarly, different sprints and more and more complex the things become, so we can just automate, and we can just reuse those things, those coded things, the automation scripts, and we can use for the testing. So that will save our time in manual things, and all the things will get automated. So that will be cost reduction. The things would be reliable, as the machine would be doing all the work. So you just don't have to depend upon the things. So next thing, after all these concerns, we just check out that okay, we will adopt a mobile automation, but which mobile automation tool to be used? That comes the second question. Okay, so over here I will introduce the APM. So now, what is APM? What is APM and why APM? APM is an open source test automation tool. It's allowed testing for all types of applications, such as native applications, web applications, and hybrid applications. So I think most of the people would be knowing about these different types, as the native applications are the applications which are built by particular platform. Means if the application is built on the Android Studio, then particularly that will be available in the Play Store as well. So those are the native applications. The examples of the native applications can be the most frequent applications which are available on our phone, such as camera, calendar, and all such things. Similarly, hybrid applications. Hybrid applications are those applications which are the combination of mobile native applications and the mobile web application. Now, you would be assuming that what is mobile web applications? Okay, so whenever we are just checking out one particular website on our mobile mobile phone through browser, so that is the version, so that is what we are talking about. That particular thing opened in the browser is called as mobile web application. So native application is the combination of the hybrid application is the combination of native and mobile web applications. So for example, if we want to take an example, the native apps are which I told, the camera, calendar, and all such things which come on our platform by default, on our mobile phones by default, are the native applications. Hybrid applications, we can take before the Facebook was hybrid applications, but now they have been switched to the native app. Similarly, the mobile applications, the website which are opened on the mobile browsers, are called the mobile web applications. So, and the most important thing about the APM is a cross-platform. So, what is cross-platform over here? As we have different automation tools to be used for mobile application testing. Those are divided as for the iOS. If we are building an iOS application, we need to jump on Calabash, iOS, Frank, UI automation. These are particularly some tools for mobile automation. Similarly, if we are building any Android application, we have different tools for Android application testing as well. RoboShyam, UI Automator, Celandroid, these are the Android application automation testing apps. So over here, where do our APM stands? The APM stands right behind between both the things. Okay. So the automation tester don't have to jump for each and every particular script for iOS and Android. He just have to sit under one hood, where he can just automate all the things which is to be tested on one particular tool, and for both the iOS as well as the Android application. Okay, as I said, APM is cross-platform. It supports both iOS and the Android. Next thing, APM supports most of the programming languages as well. if your automation engineer is not able to code up at Java, so he can just use PHP, C sharp, and he will have some random things to get the things started. Then APM handles both the simulator as well as the real devices. As in many times during the testing, we just face that whatever things we build, gets executed on the simulators, but not on the mobile applications. Similarly, let's take an example over here. Means if you are having a mobile application, okay, mobile application app you have been developed, and that particular app is running very smooth and very very UI friendly on your one particular device. So what about the second device? So that is the main concern over here. So sometimes the developers face such situations as well, where all the things are executing very fine on the simulator, but they have not tested on the real devices. So APM gives us the opportunity to test on both the things, the simulator as well as real devices. The only thing you would be doing, the only thing your automation tester would be doing is he just have to define what particular version and what particular mobile phone on which he is testing. The same thing, APM supports automation for all apps like hybrid app, native app, and web app that we spoke about. So APM is compatible with Selenium WebDriver. Anyone aware about the Selenium WebDriver over here? Okay, so Selenium WebDriver is the tool which we use for building applications as well as, so the same thing we would be using here for the APM automation scripts also. So over here, the Selenium WebDriver would be are the APIs which we use on our Eclipse tool and which we can command that particular thing on. So how does the APM works over here? APM is the mid tier over here. He will just on the server and let your mobile application communicate with your particular Selenium files, and in that way you can just whatever you would be doing is you just have to command on particular Selenium on your tool, whatever is the command, that access would be given from the APM. APM will wake your device, get all the requests, and give your result on particular Eclipse tool. So APM is free and open source, that is also the big thing, and APM is very well supported with the active Google group, building a large and thriving open source community effort. Okay, so now how to get started with the APM? So these were all the advantages and yeah. Windows also? Windows platform, I guess for Windows platform we just have some different tools as APM doesn't support on Windows platform. Yeah, it's only for Android and it's only for iOS. For Windows application, you can use one tool is there, that is CE Test Automation. For Windows, you would be using that particular tool. So Windows is not been supported by most of the automation tools. So that is the only tool, I guess, that is the thing. Okay, so how do we get started with the APM? Okay, so these are some prerequisites to use APM. Over here, I have concerned only the Windows things, or for iOS, I will just describe the thing. The first thing you would be using over here, I have used is the JDK, the Java language which I have used over here. So you would be using a JDK kit, JDK version 1.6 plus. It would not execute on a lower version. Then you would be needing the Eclipse. Eclipse is a tool where you would be writing all your commands and all your scripts for which you would be automating. You would be needing Indigo and more than that. So this is the version, particular version. Then you would be needing the Android SDK with API levels 17 or plus. As APM would not support the applications which are below 17 plus. Or we can say in other language, we can say the applications which are below the version 4, 4 in the sense ice cream sandwich. So below, if you are automating things for version 2.0 or something, so APM would not be supportive for that thing. The next thing is the Selenium WebDriver jar that we will be importing on our particular Eclipse tool. So the Selenium WebDriver jar is the tool, are the jars which you will be using for your automation scripts. The next thing is the APM for Mac and Windows, that is the APM version, that is 1.3.7.2 or plus, whatever you can take. The latest version is something around 1.4.1.16 or something like that. So you just need beyond 1.3. And next is the APK app info from your Play Store. APK app is an app which gives you all the information about which application you would be testing on. Let's take an example over here. If you are using a Flipkart app, if you want to automate the Flipkart app, so you would be needing some information about that particular Flipkart app. So on APK app info, app, you would be getting all the information such as what activity you want to get started with, what would be this build version, and all such things you would be getting on this particular app. So this particular app would be useful for you. Other than that, if you are using a Mac or iOS device, needing Xcode for waking your iOS device, and the same thing you would be using version greater than 10 for Mac. Okay, so over here I have just pasted one APM screenshot over here. This is how the APM looks like. Okay, this is for the Windows particularly. So over here, if you are using a simulator or anything like that, so you can just put out all the details and all the descriptions of your app which you are going to test on that icon which is seen on the upper left part, that is the Android. This is a Windows thing. So over here on Windows, you would be testing only Android applications and not the iOS applications. Then there are some settings, and these are the server requests, how it gets started, and we will see a demo of this particular thing, how it will get executed. Next thing is the UI automator. How UI automator would be useful? As you have seen in the behind the screenshot over here, you would be seeing a microscope over here, right? This way. Okay. What is this? This is an UI automator which gives you information about what are the things you would be inspecting, and what are the things on which you would be using that particular command. Okay, so
is a part of this APM, UI automator?
Yeah, APM, UI automator is a part of APM. Means if you want to build a script, particularly if you want to script an automation script for one particular application. So the first thing you would be using is the UI automator. Why? You just have to identify the things first, as on which particular screen you would be clicking. Let's take an example. If you have a sign in form over here, okay? You on sign in form, you have three fields. One is the username, second is the password, and third is the sign up button. Okay, so to inspect that particular element, as the human beings can inspect that this is particular thing, so I have to click on that particular thing. Okay, but how will the machine do that? We would just connect our device with the APM, we execute that particular script. And once our device communicates with our APM, you would get the description of all the things which are on your screen, on your mobile screen. So that is the thing. You would be getting the information about a particular username, the password, and all such things where your machine would be clicking to get identified that this particular thing I have to click. So that particular you have to give in your command. So in this way, the UI automator will be used. Next thing, this is one script written by me. Is it visible?
Yes.
Fine. Okay. Zoom. I think the Zoom thing is not happening over here. The same thing we will be watch this particular thing in the demo also. So in this particular script, so this is the script how we execute, how we wake up our device. So over here I have just mentioned the particular details of my things to be tested, to wake up my device, to get the things started. So you just have to give your device name, what are the capabilities, what are the version you are using, what platform it is on, then the app package. The app package you would be getting by the APK info app of whatever be the application you are using for. Similarly, the app activity also, this info also you would be getting that from that application only. So this is the thing which will wake up your Android device on which you would be testing. So here is the next thing. So this is the script where we will test at what are the things which we are going to test on the particular application. Okay, over here I have taken an example of an application. The application is something around, I have taken a demo of a hybrid application that's called Twit TV. Okay, Twit TV is an application which streams video, where you can see the live videos, you can talk about the technologies which are running, about the digital technology things. So it's an app which we would be going through in our demonstration. So over here I'm checking out one particular page, that is the schedule page. For each and every application we have different about page and all such things where the description of the applications are be given. So this is the command for one script. I have given the schedule and also we just have to verify. All these things can be done by the UI automator itself, where we have to find UI automator on the things.
But this is what you have written, right? These scripts are what you have written.
Yeah,
but
these are the scripts.
In the first line, you are finding that element by that name schedule.
Yeah.
And then you are clicking on that.
Yeah.
And then you are waiting for 5,000 seconds.
Yeah, it's not 5,000 seconds, it's 5 seconds particularly. Yeah, it's in milliseconds.
But what are you doing in the third step?
In the third step, what I'm doing is, I'm just inspected one particular item. One particular item in the sense, we have taken an example of username, okay? That is been identified over here by the driver.find element by class name, whatever be the class name of that particular script, that thing inspecting. So this would be inspected by our tool. Yeah, that's the Selenium. So it will it will examine that this particular is present over there. It will examine whatever the next thing you would be giving. If this is present over there, then you will be checking that, okay, this is fine. So we can move ahead. So similarly in the second script as well, that is the contact page. Or contact page, you would be having some static information about this has to be over here only. So that are not changed at all. So for that particular things, we can just automate the scenario.
Yeah, you're just checking the schedule and the contact us link on that mobile app.
Yes, this is the thing which would be checking in the script. So how APM works over here. This is the working architecture of APM on real devices as well as the simulators. So whatever be the, as we told, as I spoke about the Eclipse and the WebDriver scripts which we would be writing for the automation. So WebDriver scripts, whenever you write and when you execute them, the automation commands are sent in form of the JSON via HTTP protocol to the APM server. So this particular scripts would be only understood by our APM server, and the APM server will send all these particular things to our mobile device, or we can say the simulator, whatever you are testing on. So after it gets executed on the things, and we would get the input and output for that. So those are again sent, client sends back the message to the APM server. If they are all handled around the APM server, and then it will be going to the WebDriver script. Over the WebDriver script on the Eclipse tool, you would be seeing all the things which are done by your particular commands. You would be getting all the results according that which, how many test cases have been passed, how many have failed, and all such description would be shown on your console of the Eclipse tool. So this is how the APM works, APM and our script works. So the same thing, working flow from WebDriver, automation commands are sent in form of JSON via HTTP request to the APM server. APM server invokes vendor specific mechanism to execute those commands on the mobile devices. Whatever actions you have been written in the script are gone through the mobile devices. You would get the output from there. The same output would be given back to the APM server, and that APM server will just give all the logs in your console of the web driver.
So here it is simulated, like on the second point, like it says that it will execute those commands on the mobile device.
Yeah.
So here the mobile device would be the simulator that is there on the machine.
If you are using a web, mobile device or the simulator, whatever you are using, all the commands would be sent by APM on that particular thing. So this is how it will be working, whether you are using a mobile device or you are using the simulator. APM returns in which format? The same format in which he gets it, just JSON wire protocol. Yeah. Okay, so here I will show you some demonstration of my automation script which I showed you over here. Okay, I have taken over here the same app, that is the Twit TV. Over here, we will just execute some of the commands on that, at how the APM works and how it gives the results. So, okay, this is the thing, how our APM looks like. I will just for your. This is how the APM work, APM looks. Over here, it is yet started. The same thing, the commands of our commands. I made 3 scripts over here on Selenium. Some activities. Just show you the mobile device as well on the screen. It's a real mobile device. Okay? It's a real mobile device over here on which we would be executing our scripts. Before doing anything, we just have to start our APM server, which is done by this particular thing. The APM has been stopped. You just have to wake up your APM. It takes the time.
You have to place this APM folder in a specific location on a machine when we install it?
You don't have to, there is no need for the APM thing, but the Eclipse, the thing, Eclipse and your Android Studio is to be placed one on one particular thing. So over there it would be. So over here, I am going to execute this script which I have written, which I showed you on the this interface, this is just what we can say TeamViewer to just view the things. It's it is not having any communication between the APM and also. It just have to view this particular screen on over here. So in this particular script, I have written commands for checking the about section of the particular this app. So all the things are getting executed by APM, and at last we would be getting the result on our Eclipse tool in the console. Okay, so it's done. Let's check the result. Okay, so here you can see the results. We have got the script just went to the page title. Okay, it just verified the page whether that is present or not. Then it went to the schedule page. These are the some of the pages of our Twit TV. Let me show you that first. Okay. This is an application over here. You can see the live things. Watch. You have some things over here, such as featured the episodes of. The episodes related to the digital things which are trending. So this script have tested the more page. Okay, over here we are having different pages, such as schedule. What are the schedules, which are the episodes where they are going to show in this page. It just tested this particular thing, that whether it is redirected on the things or not, whether it is not redirecting on any other page. Same thing it does for the contact us page as well. In this page, it will just check out things, whether these particular things are present or not. Similarly, what is Twit TV? This is, as I told, this is an hybrid application where it will communicate with the web things as well. This is just this is the window of the application itself, but in that we have just embedded the browser things. So it tested this as well, and it tested the terms and conditions. So all these things were been tested in this particular script, and the results are like it has verified the page title, it has verified the schedule page, contact us, and for more things we can just check out the what are the things when passed by the test ng. Test ng is one more particular software which is which can be combined with the Eclipse tool to get make more descriptive about our scripts which we are writing. That is depend, that is a we can say framework. It depends upon the automation tester, that how what and how the things he would be using, and how he would be describing the things.
So do we need testng?
It depends upon the your coder, the automation engineer, whether he is using testng to make the scripts more more easy to learn. As I have used TestNG, and it is more easy to learn for the particular different users as well, that what particular things are going to be tested in this scenario. So if you are not using this thing, then you can use the J unit, that is the Java unit, where you have to write particular all the things according to the coded language what the developers do. The same things it would take here as well, but this makes the things more easy and more understanding.
It is like when you are writing this driver.find element, is like when you are finding that, so does that auto, like Eclipse auto populate things, no? Like if you type driver dot, then you will see some things auto populating, the functions that you can use like find element, get element. So where does TestNG comes into picture here? Like, do we need that, and how it is going to help me if I am trying to use APM with Selenium web driver? So, like, I have this setup on my machine. I have Eclipse. I have Selenium web driver, but I don't have TestNG. So, I wanted to know, like, how can TestNG help me if I install APM as well?
Okay, I'll show you the things how TestNG have helped in this particular commanding, right? So you would be seeing that I have mentioned here the before class method, okay? So this is how the TestNG would be useful. TestNG gives us the annotations as and where which particular the method would be executed when and how, okay? So the before class, if I am writing to execute one particular Java file, what we have to do is we just have to write all the things line by line, and the, all the things would be executing line by line only. In TestNG, you don't have that dependency. In TestNG, if you write the before class at the bottom also, then the, your command, whenever you are executing this particular command, it will execute, the first thing is the annotation. It will take execution by annotations. Annotations in the sense, it will just execute the first thing is before class. Okay, after that it will go into the methods. The methods I have not used over here, I have used the tests over here. The second annotation it will go towards is the test. The test you can give the priority. Okay, test are the priority wise you can just set out. The priority in the sense, this is the test which is to be tested first. Okay, the priority is zero. So this will be tested first. The second thing it will take up is the priority with the second test. So then it will, after the zero, it will execute the things which are written in the test priority two, priority one. So the third thing it will take is the priority is equal to zero, okay?
So test
is not a mandatory condition to run this. It just makes your testing more robust in terms of if you have multiple script files and in what order you want to execute stuff, you want to exclude something, TestNG gives you that flexibility. But it's not mandatory.
It's not mandatory. Yeah, that is what it depends upon the automation engineer whether what thing he is using. If you are not using this TestNG, then you can use the JUnit that is by default for the Java languages, whatever you are scripting. Okay. So.
Do you also capture screenshots of execution?
That's one of the limitations. For the APM, as only the functionality can be tested till now by the APM, as we just cannot inspect the screenshots and all such things by, we cannot compare the images, but we do compare the commands and whatever things, which are the things which are present on your device. So that can be inspected, but
capturing
screenshots.
Yeah. Is possible?
Yeah, it is possible. Yeah, you just have to give commands according to the whether your Selenium is supportive for that or not. So it depends upon that. And if you are giving the command, it will capture the screen as well. So this is how it will give you result according to the TestNG. And TestNG would be useful for to get your details as well. That is the more advantage for using the TestNG. Rather than if you are using only the JUnit framework, you would be getting result like this. In this particular also, you would not get the things which are written by the verified things, as this is the thing which are wrote by me, and not it is not written by the execution itself. The things which are results are the things which are written by the things are this the past one. Whether the method is been passed or not. So these are the things which are written. So yeah, we'll check out one more thing. So in this particular test case, we have got all the things passed. So how will we come to know that whether one particular command has been failed or not, whether the functionality has been failed or not, whether it is redirected on different things. So how will we come to know that particular thing? So we'll check out one other scenario over here. Okay. In this thing, we would be checking out whether all the pages are available at their with the functionality or not. Okay, so this is how it will check out whether okay the first screen, which is the featured page, it will check out the things. The first thing, the live now, the live videos. Second is the watch now and live now. These are the two things which we have scripted in this thing. So it will check out all the things and give us result whether anything gets failed. You will come to know by the test ng itself that this particular thing is failed. And it will not the test ng have one more advantage over here. If you are failing one particular script, one particular method is been failed, it will not stop its execution over there. It will just go through the next test case and it will execute that, and it will result that this particular thing is been failed and all the things other are passed. So you don't have to dig all the things that which particular thing is been failed and which are the past things. So here we got the execution.
Can we set the dependencies like if particular function is passed there only it should execute this function? Can we set these dependencies?
Yeah, we can. What we do whenever we just give these things, the command, the scripts, whenever we make scripts, we would just check out, we will write that if this particular thing is happening, then give me this result or just don't. We just have to give conditions according to the scripts, whether we are using which particular command or not. So over here, we got execution of this file as well. So in results, we will check out that the past things are two. I have written three methods in this thing, in this script. The two things got passed, these two things are working fine, but the third thing is failed, that is the watch now. Watch now in the sense that would have also been passed, but what made it failed? Okay, that is the question. What made it fail in the sense sometimes our apps don't just respond on time, right? On time, if it's not responding on time, the users may get distracted about the things and they won't be coming on the application again. So that also should not be happening with the applications whenever we are using. So over here we got the failed result. The two things which have passed, I wrote the thing which was failed, which was scripted in the second thing. So that got failed, even that got failed, but the script just got executed on the third itself, and we got the first thing passed, the second was been failed, and the third was been passed. So this is the benefit of using test ng.
Can this be used for testing performance of mobile applications, the response of any submit button or anything like that?
Yeah, we can use. That depends upon how you are scripting the things. If you have mentioned that particular scenario in your command, then it would be tested. If you are not including that thing, so it won't be, the machine would not be, the codes will not do that particular thing and just result whatever you have commanded.
So there are open different applications, like load test.
Okay.
Would that be possible?
No, that is not possible. If you are executing for one application and that application is redirecting to your different application, then this is one more limitation for the APM. That we will, for the limitations, we will speak just after the demonstration that what are the limitations which APM is having right now. So that on that particular things also we are, the APM team is working, and that would be solved as soon.
So every scenario I write is a piece of code like that?
Yeah, it's a piece of code. Whatever you are doing manually, right, as whenever you check out the things manually, you will check out this thing is working or not. So the same thing would be automated. The only difference is like over here you just don't have to sit and test out each and everything, or if you have made script for testing that particular scenario, then it will be done by the machine itself. That is also not dependency, as we have said that developer is not dependent. Okay, you just need the basic concepts of the programming language which you are using, and APM provides you different languages to use. To whichever language you are familiar with, you can just get started with the things on the Eclipse tool and you can get started with the automation. So whatever things you are going to do manually, the same things would be done by automation. The only thing you would be saving over here is your cost of testing out the things. You would not need more and more people to test out that thing. So that thing can be done by if you are using 5 manual tester and 1 automation tester. So that would be your benefits of cost cutting. That would be reducing your cost of testing. That will save your time as well. And these are all the benefits of using the automation.
Can I write a similar script to test AJAX requests?
AJAX requests. AJAX in the sense?
Yeah. Requests that happens in the background that does not reload the page, something like that.
The things which would be working background would not be things. Would not be tested over here. Would not be worked over here.
So like any kind of pop up.
The web service for the web services automation, you can just use different things which are applicable for the API things. That would be done by different automation tools. But this is the APM. This would be checking out the user interface and not according to the backend things. So this is the difference between the API services testing and this is the UI. Means that would be in the development phase. If your application is very well based and it's done in the sense, and that after that particular thing only you would be using the automation, and not before that. If such screens appears, your automation script would just halt over there and give result that this thing, what the script was finding, that was not found, but another screen has been occurred. So that will be given in your console. That would be resulted on your console.
No, but that is part of the functionality. Like I click on login and a pop-up appears, you are logging in.
Okay.
So I need to close that. So I need to click on the close thing or OK thing. So any kind of pop-up on any site. So if I want to...
Yeah, you just have to exception handling. That would be useful over here. Exception handling in the sense, if you have given that command that if any other things would be coming, so you just have to accept or deny such things and move
ahead. So someone is trying to ask is how do we handle pop-ups, or how do we test the pop-up functionality. So Selenium has inbuilt pop-up methods, so you can just add them to your script and the pop-ups would be handled. And the script would not halt because
halt.
Of pop-ups.
Yeah. That is the thing. Yes, you can. Means you just have to give the particular as what we do in the web application testing. Okay, web application we can just check out that this particular thing is present in this dimension or not. The inspection. If you are able to inspect that particular thing, then you can just verify that that is having this scenes or not. So you can do that.
Suppose we have a native application where we are supposed to test the Wi-Fi as well as the Bluetooth features. So is there any possibility to test in the APM?
For that, those are like what we can say is Wi-Fi and
Bluetooth
native features. Yeah,
yes.
Those native features I am not knowing right now, but what we are concerned about APM is checking out the from the UI itself whether the functionality is not hampered.
So it means the visible features which will be tested by the APM, not
yeah.
the hidden features.
Yeah, not no other things like the those would be coming in the API services, I guess. So that is the thing that would be backend, and if you just have to start your Bluetooth and what check out that it has been connected to one particular Bluetooth or not,
yes.
that can be done. Whatever whatever things you do manually by from the UI, that can be automated,
okay.
but the backend things won't be automated. No, I am not having that. We are more concerned about the mobile devices over here. So that is the thing. There comes a scenario in various factors where the things run and execute successfully on the simulators, but they don't get executed on mobile real devices. So that is the thing. We are doing it on the mobile devices itself and not on the simulators. Yeah, the Windows application, from Windows you can just test only the Android things. For Mac, if you are using a Mac, then you can just switch both the things, whether you are checking the iOS application or the Android application.
Yeah, but the point is, sorry.
From a Mac, both can be checked.
Yeah, both the things can be checked.
But the point is, generally we will be testing with the simulator because we would only have a couple of devices near to us which we can connect to our computer. But there are so many devices now that we would like to test that we don't have. So generally we will be using a simulator. So what is the way, like you just connected right now and with a real device and we saw those tests running. So how do we do this with the simulator?
Simulator in the sense, as what I said, the UI automator. Okay, the UI automator will let you know about the things. What we can say is, on the simulators, there are certain applications. Means the same things we have examined this thing, that the things work, the application works fine on the simulator, but it doesn't work on the devices. So that is the main scenario which we face. So
I think the thing that you're saying, that some things appears to work fine on the simulator, but actually they're not. But those are kind of design issues or loading issues that are there, that the visual issues are there. But I think as far as the functionalities are concerned, where we just are verifying if there are five sort of links on home page that we're looking for, I think that would also work on a simulator.
Yeah, the functionality wise it will work. But what about the UI things? Means if it is not been inspected on a simulator and it is present on the mobile devices, then that application will not be useful for the things.
Yeah, but
and at last we would be launching that mobile application on the mobile itself. So it would be great if we test out on the devices itself and not on the simulators. Yeah, it can. Yeah, but the things depends over here. Again, the dependency itself. The iPad have the big screen. Okay, right. The buttons would also float over there as you are talking about the responsive thing. So if that is not inspected by your APM automation, right? So in this thing, I have just defined two devices over here in the code itself, right? Whether I want to check it out on Galaxy phone or I have to check it out on the Nexus phone. So this is the thing. How?
You mean that just with a different test suite, the responsiveness can be handled?
Yes, that is it. So over here we are talking about the the failed test cases, right? The failed test cases over here was the watch now thing, right? So in this particular thing, you would be getting all the things that what are the reasons why it was been failed, okay? Next thing, we would check one more thing over here. The same application, with the different scenario. Over here, this will be the dependency. Dependency in the sense, if you are, let's take an example of YouTube. Okay, sometimes YouTube may not load particular video, right? If you are using a, if you are connected on a less speed internet, okay, and it is not loading, so that would be a negative scenario for the things. Okay, so that is also to be handled. So over here, in this application, as I told, we would be having the different episodes, and those are executing fine on particular manner on time or not. So this would be tested over here. Okay. So the first thing on the featured page was the first episode, whatever be the things. Okay. It will play. It will check out whether if it's play, it will get the. We will be getting the play and pause button as well. Okay. So that is been scripted in this thing. So if the video gets play, it will result that okay, it is playing and all the things are working fine or not. So let's check out the result in that way. As we saw in the UI that both the pages were the script just redirected us on both the pages, but the play button was not been there, right? If the play button is not there, then how can the execution be done? So in this one scenario, it got verified for one video, but for the another video, it didn't find any play button. So one got passed and the second got failed. So we just have to work out on the second thing, whether the second element, why the second element is not generating the things. So in this way, we would be knowing that where is the fault, so we can just report it out. So this was the demonstration of our hybrid application. So now we will move to the limitations of the APM. Okay, limitation APM are the it doesn't support image comparison. That's what we talk about, as image comparison is not the thing. So that is been working out. So it doesn't support the testing of Android versions lower than 4.2. If your version is lower than 4.2, then APM is not the thing which you are going to use. You just have to test it out for version greater than 4.2. It's limited support for testing hybrid applications. Hybrid applications have redirection most of the times, as as we are on one application and we just click some links and we get redirected on the things. So that is not been handled by the APM. Long time to configure for Android as well as iOS. But once it has been configured, then you just have ease to automate all the things which you are need.
By long time, do you mean that the steps are complex, or do we get stuck in between, or we face different problems when configuration?
Yeah, that depends upon the platform which you are using, and it's like that. It's a long procedure in the sense. It's not like that you won't be able to do, but you would be able to do, but it will take some time to configure all the things. That is the only thing.
What is the best supported platform?
Best supported platform would be the Mac. Yeah, would be Mac. It would give you ease to work on Android applications as well as the iOS applications.
So you said that this has a main community forum as well, so any questions asked would be answered.
Yeah. So no support to run APM Inspector on the Microsoft Windows. That is the thing. That is one more lack over here. So to use the APM Inspector, we just have to switch on the Mac devices, where you would be having the ease to check out, to inspect each and every thing what you are going to write in the scripts. Yeah. Any other questions?
Yeah. Sorry.
We are just done.
Thank you.
2 more minutes. Yeah.
If there are multiple browsers on my phone,
okay,
how do I know which browser will actually get
executed? That is a scenario where you just have to check out the web mobile application, right? You just have to wake up your particular browser. If you are checking an application, okay, which is not having any application, but it is an web application, right? Desktop application. In that scenario, you just have to wake up your Chrome, whatever your browser, you want to test it out, okay? And on that, you just have to wake the same thing which we are waking the application, the same thing you would be waking up your Chrome browser or whatever browser you are comfortable with, and all the things would be scripted over there. Yeah. Yeah, it would be Chrome driver. The same things would you would be giving is the Chrome driver. That is it. Yeah, it's just one line of code. The things you are giving, that activity and all such things of your application, that over there you just have to give your browser things.
Yeah,
Firefox comes by
default.
Yeah, Firefox
comes. You have to install the
driver. Yeah, just one driver, and that is also been done. Okay, thank you. For more queries, you just can.